Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Good morning. We're here for the celebration of the life of a great woman, a friend, a mother, a grandmother, someone who laid out her life as one of service. When I testified at the trial of the manufacturing company for the plane, on the plane that crashed with the governor aboard and his son, they asked me one question about the value of Mel Carnahan. And I told them what I'm about to tell you. My wife Diane and I were invited to spend the night at the governor's mansion, have dinner. And we did. We had a great day and a great evening. And as we sat down to eat dinner, the governor said, "Emmanuel, I want you to consider running for lieutenant governor." And I thought he was getting ready to laugh. And so he did not. And I said, "Governor, this is Missouri. What do you think?" I mean, I said, "Do you remember when Alan ran?" And he said, and I still can't believe it. He said, "Well, what are you talking about?" Said, Governor. And both of them, the governor and the first lady, I mean, they were confused. And it's like, well, what does that have to do with it? And I told that in the courtroom because I think it was an illustration of who they were and what they believed and how they lived. And then we built a new church, St. James United Methodist Church, and we had a big opening for the church. It was at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and I invited Jean to be the speaker. And I kept thinking, you know, I shouldn't do this. This is, you know, putting too much pressure on her. Church was packed, people couldn't get in. And I thought, well, this is terrible. And so I introduced her, and she walked up to the microphone and asked and acted as if and spoke like she was the pastor. Who is this woman? And I mean, and people in the black church, people were standing, just standing and waving. And I thought, oh my goodness, she's going to take my congregation. And I've shared that a number of times, but I would like to just say that it's a sad day, but also a joyful day, because we had a chance to have Jean Carnahan in our lives, and the state had her in two separate kinds of life. As the First Lady, and then as our senator. And what a family. I want to tell you about Charles Plum, the U.S. Navy pilot. He flew about 75 combat missions during the Vietnam War. On his 75th, his plane was shot down by a surface-to-air missile, and he parachuted, but was captured and put in a North Vietnam prison for 6 years. When the fighting ended, he went home, of course. And then one night, he and his wife are in a restaurant in New York City. And he could feel somebody just staring at him from a few tables away. And every now and then he would glance at the person. And then finally the person got enough courage, I guess, to come over to talk with him. It was a man in his 50s, and he said, "Are you Charles Plum, sir? I hate to interrupt your meal." And Plum said, "Well, yes." And he said, "Did you fly missions off the aircraft carrier Kitty Hawk?" And he said, "Yes." And he said, "Well, how do you know all of that? And why would you remember that kind of thing?" And he said, "There's no way I will ever forget it." And so Plum said, "Well, why?" And he said, "I'm the one who packed your parachute." I'm the one who packed your parachute. And if you allow that to just ruminate, I think Jean Carnahan and his family, for years and years and years, and still, are packing parachutes for the people of Missouri. And even another generation is coming of parachute packers from the Carnahan family. And God has blessed you richly and deservedly. You had your mom, you had your grandmom. And so start learning how to pack those parachutes right now. God bless you.
Thank you. Denise, that was beautiful. Good morning. What do you think, Reverend? Do that again? A little more? Good morning. In the opening of Mom's autobiography, Don't Let the Fire Go Out, she wrote, "If you're looking for a good cry, put this book back on the shelf and look elsewhere." But like any authentic and honest telling of one's life, there were sad parts. Like all of her books, though, it was a vivid reflection on the joys of living and stories of hope, laughter, renewal, and human connection. And that's what I hope we can do here today. In another book, The Tide Always Comes Back, Mom wrote, "Grief, sorrow, and despair are common to each of us in some measure. But like the night, our despondency is not meant to be permanent. Events can shatter our understanding, but gradually a new day comes, replacing the old with light and hope. Each deliberate step, each decision, each forced smile helps turn back the darkness and hastens the dawn." She went on to quote Psalm 30, verse 5, "Weeping may endure the night, but joy comes in the morning." Yes, we're all terribly sad to say goodbye to this extraordinary woman, but she wanted to be remembered as the person who touched our lives, gave us inspiration and meaning, and consistently brought a smile to our faces. In this time of loss, let's remember tenderly, but move forward with renewed passion and purpose to serve others and leave this world a little better than we found it. And luckily, she showed us exactly how to do this through her actions 24 years ago and every day since. She never let us stop and feel sorry for ourselves. To be honest, we were just doing our best to keep up. Many of us were able to gather for her 90th birthday party last September. While she didn't turn 90 until December, she wanted to do it when the weather was nice and when it would be more convenient for people who traveled from out of town. Mom always loved a good party, and man, did she ever enjoy that one. It was a lovely fall evening outdoors, surrounded by delicious food, family, and friends. When I spoke that evening, I noted that making a speech in front of Jean Carnahan could be intimidating, even when she was your mother. Expectations were high because Mom knew the power of words better than anyone I've ever known. When she went to the Senate, I spent a lot of time with her there. One thing you begin to notice at political gatherings in D.C. that unless it's the actual president himself speaking, nobody in the crowd gets quiet and listens to the speaker. The only exception to that I experienced was Mom. When she spoke, you could hear a pin drop. She just had a way of capturing people's attention and imagination. The words she chose to say, but also how she said them. You had to listen, and if you did, you were always rewarded. At one of her speeches, I even saw her bring a lobbyist to tears. This is an experience I think her chief of staff, Roy Temple, could probably attest to that was likely repeated in a smaller setting in her office when she was pushed to vote on something contrary to her values. While Mom showed us the path, we showed her our love and never let her walk alone. She was followed to D.C. by a talented and devoted staff, as determined as she was to make a difference in people's lives. I recently received a note from one of them, Amy Jordan Wooden, which I think captures the sentiment of the staff. "When your mom took Mel's seat in the Senate, I was never more honored to officially work for her those 2 years. She was the epitome of strength, grace, and poise. And she was damn good at the job. Anyone who knew your parents knew they were equal partners in public service. She knew how to serve an elected office very well. But that campaign schedule and traveling back and forth to D.C. was grueling. I felt so terrible about the schedule we asked her to keep. It was unfair to her, but she did what we asked of her, and then some. I had never known anyone so strong until then." In my search for meaning during these past few days, I've taken comfort in a simple but profound idea. I want to be more like Mom. So what does that mean? It means when the world seems too much to bear, you clear your mind, embrace your heart, and take a step forward. It means showing the world who you are by what you do, and then doing it with passion. It means being the cause and not the effect. And it means staying curious, taking authentic interest in others, and sometimes not taking yourself quite so seriously. She was committed to the idea of what the author David Dunn called giving yourself away. It means obeying your warm-hearted impulses, giving compliments to strangers, and words of encouragement to those around you. For her, this was the basis of successful living. Now, this will be challenging, but I think I can do it. I think we all can do it. As Mom showed us, you've just got to practice a little bit every day. The past few weeks with Mom were difficult, but filled with so many touching moments of love, laughter, and sharing of memories. One joyous occasion was when the doctors released her from her low-sodium diet. And we did not hesitate to take advantage of this gift from heaven. First up, it was pad thai, followed by a Fadley's crab cake flown in from Maryland, Pappy's barbecue, Miley, and pie pizza. Russ and Deborah brought old-fashioned chocolate sodas from the fountain, a childhood favorite. And it will not surprise you that much of the outpouring of support we've received over these last few days has come from the local chef and restaurant community. She loved them, and they loved her back. On her blog, she had a policy of only writing positive reviews. If she didn't like a place, she just wouldn't write about it. I asked her about this once and encouraged her to be a little more hard-hitting if she'd had a bad experience, and she simply responded, "Nope, not gonna do that." She said on her blog that anyone brave enough to take up a skillet and a spatula should be encouraged in their pursuit. She was attended to by so many caring people. I want to specifically thank her close friends, Lucy and Cindy, for all they did for her all the time, but especially in the last couple of weeks. Also, the staff at Barnes and Evelyn House, who showed so much professionalism, but also showed the best of humanity. Mom, of course, helped bring this out. When they came in to ask how she was doing, she typically turned the question around and asked how they were doing instead. Do you have children? How did you get into the medical profession? What's happening in your life right now? They loved her and laughed with her in their brief time together. On Mom's second day at Evelyn House, her attending physician appeared wearing her Still With Mel button. That was the moment where all of what was happening and what had happened 24 years ago came together and was distilled down into an indelible, overwhelming feeling of beauty and human connection. And a reminder, there are still causes worth fighting for, ones that are worthy of our lives. And Mom, we're not gonna stop fighting or give up in the face of so many forces that wanna turn people against each other and turn this country backward. We're not gonna let the fire go out. And we're gonna remember the quote from Winston Churchill that you prominently displayed on your desk, which said, "Never, never, never give up. In this, you have our promise." In one of our final conversations, we were alone, holding hands, and she looked at me and said softly, "I did my best." Yes, Mom, you did. And we'll keep doing our best to keep up. I love you.
Everybody. Ooh, you're getting better at this. All right. I appreciate all of you being here and for all of the love and support you've given our family over the past few weeks. I'm going to start with a little story, and that is that shortly after Mom arrived at Evelyn's house, the hospice that BJC has out in West County, a chaplain came in to see her. And as always, as Tom said, she was the one who started with the questions. How did you come to be a minister? How do you like this line of work? So all of that just was very natural. And after they visited, their visit wound up, Mom said, "Can I tell you a story?" He didn't have much choice. He says, "Sure." And she said, "You know, once I was attending a funeral for a minister, and the officiant spotted me in the audience and said, 'Senator Jean, it is so good of you to be here. Can you come up and say a few words?'" Well, she was not prepared to say a few words, nor did she even know the deceased all that well, but she stood up, walked up to the pulpit, gathered herself together, and started reciting John 14. "In my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you." And the amen started going. "Rev, I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you unto myself." And so at this point, the amens had reached her crescendo, and she headed back to her seat. And so she turns to the hospice chaplain and says, "So, remember this. If you have to speak at a funeral for somebody you don't know very well, remember that verse. It's a really good one." So, Jean Carnahan was an encourager until the very end. Now, lots of you all can recite Mom's impressive biography. She thrived as a mother, as a Sunday school teacher. She was an artist, a community organizer, a political advisor. She was a motivational speaker. She was the First Lady of Missouri. She wrote 7 books. She was U.S. Senator, and yes, she was a food blogger. To me, the most remarkable thing about Mom was that every single time in every one of those roles, she inspired hope, she encouraged us to be our best, and she always found the words that could make us laugh. Now, it never took very long for people to see that Mom was incredibly smart and curious and funny and gracious and kind and determined and competitive and fun to be with. And so growing up, I just thought Mom seemed pretty good at everything. But in truth, there were exceptions to that. She was always terrible with directions. She could not carry a tune. But it wasn't until later in life that I really realized how unusual it was for anyone, much less a parent, to so seamlessly move and transition from one role to the next, and to do it with such grace and good humor. As a result, we were all given this gift that we believed that anything was possible, anything was within reach. We could reinvent ourselves if we wanted to, because Mom always did. For me, she was absolutely a role model of a life well lived. So she figured out somehow early in life that she was both the author and the main character of her life story. Sometimes that meant she could unleash her creativity and do remarkable things and drive the plot line forward. Other times, fate would intervene. It might have some new plot twist. Maybe it came because of a mechanical failure. Maybe it came because of a terrorist attack. Maybe it was a bolt of lightning. Maybe it was an election cycle. In every one of those situations, Mom understood that it was her job and her opportunity to decide how she would respond. And I think part of what made Mom so inspiring for all of us who knew her well, but even for those who didn't, was how even in the face of uncertainty and doubt and fear, she just willed herself to take the next step. to not feel sorry for herself, to never stop, to just keep going. Now, it was a little bit hard to pinpoint where that strength and determination came from. But I think she would attribute it to two things. One, growing up in a working class family where she was raised to just do the job at hand. And the second was her deep faith, knowing that even in our darkest moments, we're not alone. She called it the great certainty. A loving God is with us always. Now, storytellers like Mom have their favorite stories. And as Tom mentioned, she read this book, Try Giving Yourself Away, as a young girl. And she decided to put that author's philosophy to work in her life. So she took opportunities to give something that didn't always have to be of value to someone every single day. And it turned out to be like a superpower for her, right? Because she could take any situation and make it a little bit better. That brought joy to her life and certainly to the lives of people around her. Just last week, I was stopped by a doctor's office, and the woman who checks people in at the doctor's office came and gave me this giant bear hug. I didn't even know who this person was. And she said, I loved your mother so much. She was so much fun. So I know that Mom encouraged a lot of people, more than I'll ever know. And it never stopped, even as her physical strength began to wane. She also loved the story about Harriet Tubman, a slave who found freedom in Canada, but didn't stay there. She kept coming back to the South to bring more people to freedom, across the Mississippi River, just not too far from here. And Harriet had a way of saying to her team that there was no turning back. She'd say, children, if you're tired, keep going. If you're scared, keep going. If you're hungry, keep going. If you want to taste freedom, keep going. Mom always kept going. She saw it as her job to make the world, her community, her state, her friends, her family, everyone, a little bit better. And it was that commitment in the spirit of the Jewish traditions tikkun olam that animated all of her words and deeds. And I got to admit, as a child, I'm sure the grandchildren can say the same thing, that we didn't always appreciate her effort to make the world and us a little bit better, particularly when it was sort of trying to fix one of our bad habits. But let me see a show of hands of how many of you all shared a meal with my mother, looked at her blog, looked at her restaurant reviews, shared a recipe. Like, okay, so you know what great joy she got over the last 10 years writing for that food blog on Good Food STL. She was constantly on the lookout for new discoveries. It was a great creative outlet for her, both her writing, but also staging photos, making sure the light was perfect, all of the things. A friend of mine said the other day when her meal came that she like instinctively waited to take a bite because she knew she had to take a picture for Jean. So I want you to know that we plan to keep that blog up. We may change its format a little bit. We want to be a resource and remembrance of my mother. You can clap for that. So as I close, I feels right to give my mother the final words because she was always the best writer in the family. And these come from her book, The Tide Always Come Back. If after reading this book, you feel a little more kindly toward a neighbor, a coworker, or a relative, if you believe a little harder, if you forgive a little more freely, if you encourage the young, the old, or the hurting more frequently, if you wake up and see each new day as a gift from God packed with possibilities, if you work on what you can give back to your country more than what you can take from it, if a story, a quote, triggered a smile, a determined effort, or a new way of looking at the world, then I'm glad to have been part of your life. Thank you, Mom, for being such an important part of our lives, for inspiring all of us to keep going, to keep encouraging, and to keep having fun along the way.
Couple of things about that picture. I feel like I should explain it. Number one, as you heard from Denise's first song, this building has incredible acoustics. But the lighting is off because it makes my dark brown hair look white. But the more serious part of that, the story of that picture, is that it was the day after Jean lost her election by a mere 20,000 votes statewide. And we were at the campaign headquarters, and I had just said to her, "Gosh, Jean, I sure hope you don't feel like we let you down." And on a day when we should have been comforting her, as you can see, she was comforting us. So I'm Roy Temple, and I had the privilege of serving as chief of staff for Jean during her time as U.S. Senator, and before that, serving in the same position for Mel during his time as governor. I got to tell you, offering words on the life of a gifted speaker and writer like Jean Carnahan is a bit like being asked by Leonardo da Vinci's family to sketch the great artist as he worked on the Mona Lisa. You quickly realize there's no chance you're gonna do the subject justice, but I'll do my best, which is all Jean ever asked of any of us. It's lost to history who taught Jean how to share, but whoever taught her, it stuck with her for a lifetime. Throughout her life, she shared with all of us in countless ways. Of all the things Jean shared, perhaps the most obvious was her joy for life. In the past few days, I've looked through literally thousands of photos of Jean. And when you see the candid photos of Jean with others in moments both ordinary and extraordinary, you're first struck by the joy on Jean's face. And then, even more so, by the smiles on the faces of those who are lucky enough to be in her presence. Jean also shared with us an enormous capacity for painstaking, loving, and detailed work on the projects and causes she embraced. I remember sitting in the basement of the law office in Rolla, watching Jean supervise the development of one of the first and most sophisticated databases in Missouri politics, far before technology was widely used in that way. She was always a woman ahead of her time. She was just as meticulous as First Lady in researching the history of the mansion and the families who'd lived there and writing a book about it, or overseeing the fundraising, the planning, and design of the children's fountain. And finally, in supervising the bust that now is displayed in the governor's honor near the mansion. She poured her heart and soul into whatever her current effort was, and there was always a current effort. Jean also shared with us her commitment to serving others. In 1993, Mel and Jean left for a long-planned and long-delayed vacation to Italy. But when flooding took a turn for the worse, those of us on Mel's staff notified Mel and Jean, and they rushed back to Missouri after a single dinner in Rome. So instead of enjoying a well-deserved vacation, Jean spent all of July 1993 traveling with Mel to flooded parts of Missouri, helping sandbag and comforting families who were suffering devastating losses. Jean also shared her bravery, strength, and selflessness. One of the bravest things I ever saw Jean do was just a few days after the crash at Chris Sifford's funeral in my hometown of Paxico. I was sitting on the stage of our high school gym where Chris's friends and families had gathered. We were all almost paralyzed by grief. I'd barely been able to get to myself to the podium to offer Chris's eulogy. So I was amazed when I looked out into the audience and saw Jean Carnahan, whose grief was so much more profound than my own, rise up and come to the stage to speak to Chris's friends and family. She knew her words would be a comfort to us, so she did what she needed to do. As Senator, Jean shared her grit, her smarts, her character, and moral convictions, and showed that she had a backbone of steel. I remember the day Jeffrey Skilling, Enron's former CEO, testified before the Permanent Subcommittee on Investigations after his company collapsed. Mr. Skilling was certain that he was the smartest person in every room he'd ever been in his life. But when Senator Carnahan questioned him at that hearing, it wasn't a fair fight, because her questions were coming from a person with a clear sense of right and wrong, something Mr. Skilling lacked entirely and something Jean Carnahan had in spades. But as anyone who knows or met Jean knows, she was quick to share her wit and humor. During Mel's time as governor, he attended the National Governors Association meetings in Washington. One year, President Clinton and First Lady Clinton invited Mel and Jean to stay in the Lincoln bedroom at the White House. The next day, when I saw Jean, she told me that in Mel's haste to repack for the overnight to the White House, he'd forgotten his pajamas. She then proceeded to tell me that she thought it would be hilarious if I were to leak that human interest tidbit to Jerry Berger, who was then the gossip columnist at the St. Louis Post-Dispatch. I told her, I said, Jean, I'm not sure Mel would be particularly happy with me if I did that. And thinking I was pretty clever, I wisecracked, I'm not sure if you've noticed this, but Mel can be a little bit uptight. Without missing a beat, Jean retorted, if you think he's uptight now, you should have seen him before I got a hold of him. No matter what was going on in her own life, Jean always found ways to show and share kindness toward the people around her. Just a few days after 9/11, Stacy, my wife, had our first daughter, Natalie. A year later, Jean was still a grieving widow and mother, a freshman senator, and in the midst of a hotly contested campaign for re-election. But despite all the demands on her, Jean was aware that Stacy and I were stressed out new parents, far away from our own families. So she found ways to show her love and support for us. With the help of folks like John Beakley and Rachel Storch, Jean hosted Natalie's first birthday party right there in her Senate office. Natalie wasn't old enough to remember it, but Stacy and I will never forget it. Jean was also generous in sharing her husband and family. Rather than being jealous of the time and attention that politics and public service required from Mel, Jean instead turned it into something they could share and enjoy together as a family. But Jean also passed her instinct for sharing to the next generation of Carnahans. Over the years, countless people, almost everyone in this room, have had the privilege of working for, being inspired by, or benefiting from the work of both Jean and Mel. And so on behalf of all of us, let me offer a sincere thank you to you, the entire Carnahan family, the kids, your spouses, and the grandkids. Thank you for sharing them with us. And thank you for making us all feel like we were part of your family. We fully recognize that what was entirely our good fortune involved many sacrifices for you. And for that, we offer you our heartfelt gratitude. Throughout Jean Carnahan's amazing life, she shared her wisdom in her speeches and in her numerous books. And one piece of wisdom Jean often shared was a quote from Mr. Astrobus, a character in Thornton Wilder's play, The Skin of Our Teeth. It goes, I know that every good and excellent thing in the world stands moment by moment on the razor edge of danger and must be fought for, whether it's a field or a home or a country. Jean understood the good and the excellent things in the world worth fighting for. Family, friends, democracy, our children. And she fought for them every day in ways large and small with wit and good cheer. So when we leave here today, let's renew our commitment to the good and excellent things in this world, to never take them for granted, to fighting for them in ways large and small, and to doing it with wit and good cheer. And in doing so, we will be making our world a better place and also be honoring and sharing the legacy of Jean Carnahan. Senator Carnahan, may you rest in peace.
It's easy for me to remember who I am. When I'm in Washington, because it's where I grew up. My mother was a hairdresser and my father was a plumber. They were the first ones in their family to own their own home, and that was very important to them. I went to the public school a few blocks away and to the church on the corner. I was the first person in my family to receive a high school diploma, the first to get a college degree. Mel and I met in high school. His family had moved to Washington when his father was elected to Congress. And one Sunday evening, he came to our church youth group. And the next morning, he was in the alphabetic seating arrangement next to me in my home room. My name was Carpenter, and of course, with his being Carnahan, we were seated next to each other throughout high school. We had our first date shortly after we met. And by our second date, he told me he was going to marry me and go into politics. We went to college together, and we were married 3 days after graduation. Soon, we moved back to Missouri to raise a family. Randy and Russ, Robin and Tom. Everything was a family affair, including campaigns.
After Mel was elected governor, Jean cherished her time as First Lady, writing books, opening up the mansion to the public, and as a longtime advocate for Missouri's children, commissioning a fountain on the mansion grounds in their honor. But in October of 2000, everything changed.
So he called me up. He had just gotten in the plane. The event was over, and I could hear the plane in the background. And he says the weather's kind of bad, but it's just immediately where we are. After we take off, it should be fine. And I'll be home for dinner. So keep some dinner for me, and I'll be home for dinner. And then it wasn't too long after that I get a call from the security people downstairs, and one of them says he wants to come up to see me, which I thought was very strange. They never did that. And Alan Walton came up, and he walked in, and he walked over to the desk where I was and knelt down on one knee. And when he did, I knew exactly what he was going to say.
It is with great sadness that we report that earlier this evening, a plane believed to be carrying Governor Mel Carnahan, his son Roger, and senior campaign advisor Chris Shepard went down in Jefferson County.
Do you not know, have you not heard, that a prince and a great man has fallen this day in Israel?
One of my fondest memories growing up was coming downstairs on a winter morning and seeing a warm, glowing, bright fire in the fireplace. Because every morning, Dad would get up early and light the fire. And without fail, before he walked out the door in the morning to go to work, he'd say, "Don't let the fire go out." So I'm here today to say, Dad, we promise we won't let the fire go out.
We are going to go to Rolla, Missouri now, where Jean Carnahan, the widow of the late Governor Mel Carnahan, apparently is about to announce she would be willing to serve in the United States Senate if her late husband wins next week's Senate election.
Should the people of Missouri elect my husband, I pledge to take their common dreams to the United States Senate. Soon, Missourians will reaffirm their belief in self-government by casting their votes. Mel Carnahan's name will still be on that ballot, and his vision for Missouri can still prevail if we want it to. With the support of my family, I've decided to do what I think Mel would want me to do, what he wants all of us to do, to keep fighting with all the strength we can muster for the values and ideals that he lived for. Now the choice is up to you.
Jean served in the Senate at a remarkable time for her and for the country. 2 days after her family home was struck by lightning and destroyed by fire, the planes hit the Twin Towers. She was flown back to D.C. by the Department of Defense, accompanied by two fighter jets as escorts. The Senate was evenly divided among party lines. and the building that housed her Senate office was shut down because of an anthrax attack.
Senator Carnahan has worked hard to help us obtain federal funds to fight the meth problem in Missouri.
I was proud to be with the first group of U.S. senators to go to Afghanistan to meet with our troops and the country's new leaders.
I just fear that you reduced a conversation about character to a conversation about money, and that was my concern. I'm concerned that the bankruptcy of this company does not compare with the bankruptcy of character that occurred in the executive suite.
Earlier this year, I met with troops fighting the war in Afghanistan, and one of them showed me a card some school children had sent him. Inside, they had written, "Take care of America for us." He told me that's our job. I sponsored legislation that extended health care coverage to reservists and National Guard members returning from Afghanistan, because I know that taking care of the people who take care of America is my job.
Jean Carnahan. Wife. Mother. Grandmother. Writer and food blogger. Community leader. First Lady. And the first woman to represent Missouri in the United States Senate. As at ease with world leaders and celebrities as she was with small children. Doing important work, but never taking herself too seriously. And bringing her wit and good cheer to every person she met. A role model for all, who leaves us with this wise advice.
I'm often reminded of the words of St. Paul, who said, "While we have time, let us do good."
Thank you. In her last few days, as if preparing to be shot out of a cannon, Mom told us and her doctors, "I'm ready to blast out of here." Robin asked her, "Where are you going?" She said, "Wherever the good Lord takes me." She wasn't just ready. With her deep faith, she knew where she was going. And she knew with all her heart that we would be okay. While driving her home from one of her last doctor visits, she very plainly told me she was not worried about dying. And she had been so very blessed with a full life and a loving family. And of course, Mom had a file for this day. Mark's funeral, containing a typed page titled, "Mere Service Suggestions." So welcome to the service that Mom planned with just enough detail of her wishes and just enough ambiguity to require us to collaborate and make things right. She wanted us to be celebrating her life and not sad. Even though her 90-year-old body was failing, her mind was sharp. Maybe sharper than ever, because she was focused and determined on her path ahead. Sunday morning before she died, I'd spent the night on the sofa in her hospice room, and I asked her if she wanted to watch Meet the Press. I was struck by her curiosity, her insight, and confidence about the future. She really liked that there was a woman anchor and wanted me to remind her of her name. Kristen Welker, I said. She liked that there was a woman Republican presidential candidate still standing up to the former president. She liked the groundswell of support for women's rights across Missouri and the U.S. She had confidence that President Biden, her dear friend and colleague from the Senate, the country and our very democracy would be okay. Why? I believe it's because she knew she had taught us well, in both words and deeds, and to dream and dream big. Mom was constantly organizing and creating, and sitting on the sidelines was never an option. She believed that you don't just live in this world, but you shape it like an artist molding clay. Shape it to help others, to leave your community, even the world, a better place. I was thanking Mom in one of our last conversations for teaching us such great examples of creativity. And she said to me, "I had so many creative ideas, but your dad squashed most of them." We laughed. But it's what made Mom and Dad such an incredible life partners. Dad was more measured, but it was Mom's creative genius that pushed him, lifted them through the highs and lows and uncertainties of public life. Jean Carnahan was a nonstop fire hose of ideas. It could be overwhelming for some, but also inspiring. She transformed so many of those ideas into reality. And how did she do that? She was an organizer. If she were here today, she would have this entire room organized and focused on some big, worthy goal. Before Barack Obama made the term community organizer cool, that's what Mom did. Just to name a few examples. Cub Scout Den Mother. My earliest memory of her leadership skills were her organizing Randy and me and the neighborhood boys at meetings in the basement of our house in Rolla. And then there was the swimming pool campaign. In Rolla, we had a crappy old city swimming pool. And I thought I had the coolest mom around because she led the campaign for voters to fund a new swimming pool. And of course, all of Dad's political campaigns. The first election night I remember as a kid, the watch party consisted of a transistor radio on a card table set up in Randy and my bedroom next to our bunk beds. And then there was the famous 1966 Caravan for Carnahan. That's where the 8-year-old me fell in love with campaigns. We had red straw cowboy hats with stickers on the front. We had a flatbed truck with a piano on it and loudspeakers and bunting and flags and to give speeches and sing and travel around from town to town. Mom organized it all. But the most impressive political organizing she did, the few people appreciate, Roy mentioned, but was building the 1980 campaign card file, pre-computer, of thousands of 3x5 index cards with individual cards for each person Dad met or even wanted to meet as he traveled around the state. And as if that wasn't fantastic enough, then she went out and taught herself computers and transformed that into one of the best political computer databases of its day in Missouri. Mom was the most creative idea person I ever met. In one of my favorite interviews, Mom described her creative self. She said, I quote, "I'm one of those people who has lots of ideas." No kidding. She said, "I get up every morning with a dozen ideas. Most people are exhausted with the things I create to do." Mom had a seeming endless curiosity, was a lifelong student, always learning, trying and doing different things. She played the guitar, the ukulele. She was a painter, a clown. She actually went to clown school. She was a designer, a historian, a writer. That was her true passion. You know, she wrote and edited all of our speeches for so many years, wrote campaign literature, designed bumper stickers, books, all the books she wrote. The sheer number is impressive, but the most remarkable is the encyclopedic history of Missouri through the lens of Missouri First Families. But she researched and wrote over 5 years as First Lady, if walls could talk. And then there's Foodie Mom. Good food combined with witty writing was the recipe for her creation of Good Food St. Louis, with her slogan, "Eat well, travel far, laugh often." We all love becoming foodies with her and subjects of her photography most of the time, sharing food and great friendship. But still today, friends as well as total strangers often tell me they love a recipe or an article that they read from Mom. She was the matriarch of our family, in the best sense of the word. The dictionary defines matriarch as a woman who rules at a family, group, or political administration, typically known as the head of the family and its descendants. But her so-called rule was all about lifting up her family. From our entire family, we cannot express enough the deep thanks for the enormous public and private outpouring of love and admiration for Mom. It has helped us focus on celebrating her absolutely spectacular life. For Deborah, Mom loved you and appreciated the many talents and joys you brought to our family. How you've been a great mother to our boys and brought out the best in me. Austin, you were the first grandchild and forged the way for those that followed. She loved cooking with you and she learned how to be a grandmother with you. Andrew and Jackie, Grandma was so incredibly excited about your upcoming wedding. She will be with you in spirit on your special day and always. And for all the grandchildren of Jean Carnahan, and with the help of First Lady Teresa Parson when we were in Jefferson City last Thursday. One of Mom's last dreams was to have all her grandchildren at the same time visit the mansion. And although Mom couldn't be there, her grandkids got to do that together. So to all the grandkids, you're so blessed to have her time, her talents, her friendship, and fun times. She was the coolest grandma. And to quote the actor Robin Williams' character from the movie Mrs. Doubtfire, which I'm sure you've all seen, "I'm a hip old granny who can hip hop, bebop, dance till you drop, and yo-yo make a wicked cup of cocoa." She loved each of you for the special young men and young women you are and for the great promise of your future. Her example will be a guide. Some in life, especially public life, are known for examples of their power. Mom, you will always be known for the power of your example. Good examples only last as long as there are people to follow them. That's where all of you come in. Like all great writers, Mom, you left us a great outline, an unfinished manuscript. She expects us to blast out of here today with her example etched in your hearts. She expects us to dream. Dream big. And when you do, Jean Carnahan will be smiling.
Austin. Jean was my grandmother, and as people before me have said, and I'm sure all of you know, Grandma was obsessed with a wonderful reserve of grace, compassion, and good humor. I consider it to be one of the great blessings of my life to have been able to spend so much time with her, to learn from her, and to watch her lead by example. Today I wanted to share with you reading a passage from her book, The Tide Always Comes Back, that I think captures some of her incredible spirit. So, in this passage, she is sitting on the beach, musing at the waves, and this is what she has to say. "Down the beach, I spot a dinghy, partially buried in the sand. It looks much like a lithograph I once saw of an old boat stranded on the shore when the tide went out. The boat is stuck, useless, unable to go anyplace. The title of the image was The Tide Always Comes Back. What a wondrous assurance. When the tide returns, as it most surely will, the boat will be lifted to dance over the waves as it was meant to do. In the ebb and flow of life, we sometimes feel beached and hopeless. But in time, God's goodness washes over us, and we are afloat again, buoyed by his grace. Though I love the sand and surf, I have concluded that I am not a natural beach body. My skin is far too fair and requires lotions and cover-ups. My hair is inclined to frizz in humid weather, and my feet's too tender from being encased in socks and shoes. Yet, I come back to the seashore year after year. I'm attracted to the tides that splash so persistently onto the shore. I feel some kinship with this untamed force that lunges onto the beach, then retreats to familiar waters to gather strength. There's a lesson to be learned from the waves as they pound the shore with such self-abandon. Life is not always about success. It's more about mighty endeavor."
Hi, everyone. I'm Andrew, Austin's younger brother. I'm sad. I'm sad that I will never get to tell my grandmother how my day is going or what new restaurants I want to try with her. I'm sad that I won't get a phone call at 10 o'clock at night asking how to fix her television so she can watch Rachel Maddow. But my tears this past week have almost always been with a smile. I find myself looking at old photos and interviews of her life and just can't help myself but smile through the tears. I don't know how to articulate quite well what she meant to me. Yes, she was the first lady of the state. Yes, she was the first woman to represent the United States Senate in Missouri in the United States Senate, but those are just titles that she held. They did not encompass the whole of Jean Carnahan. She was a friend, a lover of food, and an advocate for the people, and one hell of a grandmother. A grandmother that was never afraid to tell you what she thought, regardless if you wanted her to. And a grandmother that would never let you think for a second that she wouldn't support you through thick and thin. She is a woman, a mother, a grandmother, and a friend worth celebrating with a smile. I'll miss her.
Carnahan, and these are my sisters, Addie and Harper. Grandma Jean took the job of encourager very seriously. In her book, The Tide Always Comes Back, she recited a Buddhist prayer whose principle she aimed to live by. May I become, at all times, both now and forever, a protector for the helpless, a guide for the lost ones, a ship for those to cross oceans, a bridge to cross rivers, a sanctuary for those in danger, a lamp for those in darkness, a refuge for those who lack shelter, and a servant to all in need. Grandma Jean was a great role model to us, whether we were reading one of her books, hearing her give a speech, or cooking with her at the farm. We had matching yellow aprons, and I was her little chef. I'll never forget all the fun we had, and I hope I can be like her one day.
When we would go to the farm, Grandma loved a busy, chaotic kitchen filled with people. As we would go through a recipe, she would question methods, make suggestions, and take notes. She also took a lot of pictures, and I knew I had to look good because I was probably going to be on the blog the next day. One of my favorite times of the year with Grandma was Thanksgiving. It was the ultimate chaotic kitchen, and she happily oversaw it. She liked to invite people who did not have other family to be with, including visiting students and people whose kids had moved away. At all meals, we were encouraged to ask questions and be a part of the conversation. She made everyone feel like their voice mattered. I was really proud to have her come to my school for Grand Friends Day a few months ago. But the best part was how we conspired, and she told my math teacher that my friend and I needed to leave class to take her on a tour. We then proceeded to goof off in the hall, and we took funny pictures of her with a science room skeleton. Grandma loved to laugh and bring people together. That's how I'm always going to remember her.
Grandma began one of her books recounting a story about being with me on a beach when I was very small. She grabbed my tiny plastic bucket and shovel and took me outside to play. I walked with her carefully towards the sand, but when it came time to take a step onto the beach, I was terrified of this unfamiliar ground. Instead of forcing me onwards, she simply threw down a towel at the edge and said, "This spot looks great." We began the work of making a sandcastle, and before long, Grandma had coaxed me off the towel and I had sand between my toes. This was the first of many lessons from Grandma about the joys of getting out of my comfort zone. With her, I tried new foods, prepared new recipes, and participated in political discussions. As I read and hear more stories about her life, it is an inspiration. Whether hot air ballooning through Turkey, going to clown classes, parasailing with me in Mexico, or becoming a U.S. Senator, Grandma showed me how to live life to its fullest. I'd like to finish with one of my favorite quotes that I read in her book. It was her statement from the election night of 2000 and said that each of us has the power to change whatever we touch, if only for a moment in time and perhaps forever. The human spirit can be rekindled from acts of courage by ordinary people. I love you, Grandma.
Family, you are loved, and all of these people are here to declare it by their presence. A few years ago, 1993, I was mayor, and I needed to get out of town. I went to Houston to stay with my sister for a weekend, and I wanted to do things, so my little niece called her in, and I said, I want to go to a movie. And so she went and got the newspaper, full page ad. It said at the top, Star Wars. And I said, wow. She said, you haven't seen that? And I said, no. She said, you're the only one. And I said, well, okay, I want to go see it. But anyway, I looked at the full page ad to try to figure out what it was going to be, and it had, you all know the names, Luke Skywalker, H2O, and so I thought, okay, I want to go. But as I read on down with all of these characters, it said, now showing Star Wars for 1 week only. And I thought, boy, what is this? And so my niece said, you read that wrong. It said, may the force be with you for 1 week only, but it had nothing to do with the movie. And I said, well, why did they put it in here? She said, stop reading when it says, may the force be with you. And I read it, but I couldn't get it out of my head, you know, for 1 week only. But on this day, may the force and the power of Jean Carnahan and her love of God and a love of you rest, rule, and abide with you now and forevermore. In the name of Jesus Christ, the resurrected Lord. Amen. Amen.